so I don't have any news on it. This question mostly, I guess, directed at Minuteman, but also USJ. So, I don't think that in the near future we're going to see the borders open up completely. And I also don't think we have resources to kick everybody out or completely protect all borders because they're huge. So, what do you think would be the effect of making legal immigration more attainable for more people? How do you feel about that, and what effects do you think it would have?
That's actually a goal that we want to have. We want to encourage people to come here legally. We wouldn't be here talking about it. That's the main goal. Like I've been reiterating, you come here with safety, respect, and dignity. Dignity, they don't have to demean themselves by assuming another person's identity and become a thief. With safety, they can bring their family and not worry about the extortion, that phone call they have to make from the drop house and trying to get enough money to come back to pay off the debt, otherwise they'd be executed. Those things are happening. So that's our goal. We want to find out different ways. And this is part of why we're here talking about this together, to find and establish our common ground. The part that we're working on at the legislature, getting different bills passed that will address this. You have a guest worker program that's, well, two of them that are being proposed right now. But my concern is, will it become legalized slavery? Because even though they propose to go along with the Labor Department's standards and protections, there's no enforcement. There's no money for the enforcement. And this was stated in many congressional meetings. Southern Poverty has a whole, and I encourage all of you, if you get to the Southern Poverty Law Center, to read a booklet that they have. It's not a booklet, it's a report, Close to Slavery. And it discusses the problems with guest worker programs.
Basically, just to piggyback off of what Mike said, kind of stole my thunder there a little bit, because I just read a report yesterday by the Southern Poverty Law Center that talks about guest worker programs. And so, again, because those two things aren't going to happen anytime soon, either mass deportation or mass legalization, there's a couple of things. Of course, we would want to have at least more opportunity for people to come here legally, for sure. One big problem with some of the guest worker programs that exist right now is that if you come over as a guest worker, your guest worker visa only allows you to work for that one employer. And that's really the key thing that creates slave-like situations, because if as soon as your employer is treating you bad, or stealing your wages, or your working conditions are bad, or they're locking you up in a trailer overnight, as soon as you complain about that, you can't go to another employer. You immediately go out of status and you can be deported. And if you complain to your employer, they'll go ahead and call the immigration authorities on you and have you deported. So that's the thing that traps people with the guest worker programs, is the fact that they have to work for that one company, and if they're not working for that one company, their visa is suddenly no longer valid. So any guest worker program doesn't necessarily need to lead to citizenship or staying here permanently and things like that. It can definitely be temporary in nature, and that would be helpful. But it has to give workers the ability to change employers if they want to.
And just a side note, it was the civil rights in the 60s that ended the Bracero guest worker program. So I obviously would not encourage going back against the gains of the civil rights.
And just for people's information, if you're interested in learning about how people can legally immigrate to the United States, the United States Citizenship and Immigration Services, USCIS.gov, has a lot of information in several different languages. Also, if you go to state.gov, the visa bulletin will let you know how long people have to wait in certain categories of employment-based immigration or family-based immigration. Many of the waiting lists exceed 15 years.
May I add also to...
Just go to state.gov in the visa bulletin. I'm not taking a side. This is if people want further information, because I think that was an excellent question. How could we make the immigration system more efficient, more agile? Take a look at state.gov, go to the visa bulletin. You'll find the waiting list for the different categories there.
May I ask one question to the audience? How many of you here, by raise of hands, know that the state of Utah is involved with one of the largest largest human trafficking cases in the United States to date. This is something you should all be aware of. It was an article in
Michael, I'll give you 2 minutes to explain this name, 2 minutes to United for Social Justice.
There's an article in Desert News that's also been carried by the Tribune exposing this. These were Thailand workers, Thais that were coming in. They came in actually legally through the system. They were recruited. And as Mr. Wagner was explaining, the exploitation of them. They're held here basically because they incur huge amounts of debt. They've actually sold their property. Some of it has been in their families for thousands of years, and now it's gone because they have to repay these debts. And they were trapped at some of the hog farms and egg farms down in Delta. This is something that has given Utah a black eye, but many people turn their eyes to it. They don't want it. The farmer that, or one of the ranchers that had recruited these people stated, in fact, that he would rather have the Thai workers than immigrants coming from south of the border because they were easier to protect. He knew that they had that debt, they wouldn't run away. It is a fault that is in the system that needs to be addressed. Is the fact that when these people come in, they're tied to one employer. And this is something that we should all, and I encourage all of you, we have to contact your representatives, your senators, because they're running two immigration bills concerning the guest worker programs. They need to know that there should be follow-ups to their protection that has to be in there before these programs are ever in place. Otherwise, this state will be sanctioning slavery.
And United for Social Justice has 2 minutes to either respond or to explain something.
I disagree with what Mike said. Amen.
And again, the easiest solution is to grant them full labor rights. Legalize, organize, unionize. It's been a long time since we've had strong labor unions, but it's worth remembering. The biggest expansion of labor unions, right? You hear all this talk about the economy. The biggest expansion of labor unions came in the 30s. It came during the Great Depression. And it's worth noting that most of that labor was not American labor. It was labor from Eastern Europe. It was labor from Southern Europe. And the best way for workers of all varieties to increase their wages is to create a united front from both immigrant labor and native labor.
I was horrified at Mr. Macero's explanation of how terrible and how destructive and how terrible this country is. And I was wondering why he was still here, and I guess he did answer that in a way, that he was here because Utah is the most terrible of all. So I'm really discouraged about that. But I was going to ask Mr. Van Wagner, he mentioned that in Mexico, along the border, it's been militarized. Now, I don't know how he got that information, because I understand that the military is not there. The National Guard was there, but they weren't even able to interact with the illegals at all. And where did you get information about a militarized border? I think they should, because the people down there are being criminalized, are being killed, their property is being destroyed.
Thank you.
And they're not being protected.
Okay, no, that's a good question. By militarization of the border, what I mean is there are, armed agents on the border with weapons, building walls, detaining people, stopping people, etc., rather than allowing more of a free flow as existed before IRCA was passed in 1986. So maybe that's not the greatest choice of words, but in a lot of books I've read, that's the word that they use. So I didn't mean to imply that the military is there, although, as you mentioned, for a short time, the National Guard, or there's been occasional talk of deploying the National Guard. They're just armed agents of the government, basically trying to prevent people from crossing, which again is a situation that did not exist to a great degree before 1986. And then again, I'd say, maybe this was directed more at Greg, but the reason that I and Greg, for example, feel that the United States has done a lot of damage in the world is from visiting some other places. And some of the places I visited are, for example, Palestine, the occupied West Bank and Gaza, and Iraq. And as Mike mentioned, a lot of Iraqis have become refugees. There's about 3 to 4 million refugees that were that have been created as a result of the United States invasion of Iraq. Roughly 1 million Iraqis have been killed. You know, it's just misery. It's the worst situation you can imagine in Iraq, and that's the result of the actions of our government. So here in the United States, our government treats us citizens pretty well. Life is great here. When you go to places that have been affected by the United States military, where there are people who are on the wrong end of an American gun or an American bomb, you would find that there's really terrible, terrible things the United States is doing, murdering, torturing, bombing, etc.
Can you talk about another project?
Yeah, I think that what Mr. Minuteman was saying when he was talking about militarization is that attempts at enforcing the law are actually taking place on the border. So I think that's what he's getting at. And of course, it's not something that they, that our adversaries necessarily agree with. So, relative to the U.S. foreign policy aspects that you just talked about, the destruction, the raping, the killing, the murder, so on and so forth. I'm not quite sure that I buy the argument. I would appreciate it if you would send me statistics that demonstrate that.
I'd like to also add with the militarization of the border, like I opened up with my statement concerning organized crime. This is where the whole central fight is. I mean, if you're looking at an illegal alien, that's just a product that's being brought over. If you look at Japan, how many of you here know that Japan's going through an illegal immigration problem like us? Okay. How many do you know Israel is doing the same thing in Egypt? How many of you know that Greece is talking about the events? So these are problems that are common to a lot of countries. It's because you get this huge influx coming in. It's not saying that you're hating people or anything like that. It's you want people to be able to come in an orderly fashion somehow. But the fact is that organized crime, by bringing these people in, by smuggling them, has become that danger. That is the real, true enemy to address.
This question is directed at the Utah Minuteman Project. I had a business for 33 years, and 6 people used false ID, false social security numbers, who worked for me over those years, and every single one of them was quote-unquote an American and was legal and was born in this country. The issue I have with some of your statistics, you talk about how much money it costs to come here, that people are supposedly paying all of these cartels all of this money. Where are they getting the money from? If they're only making $5 an hour, as you said, they're coming here, they're walking, they're coming on trains, they're hiding in trucks, they're coming across the desert by walking and by hiking to get a better life. It sounds like what you're saying is a contradiction in terms. You say,
please ask your question.
You said that people have no money, yet you say they pay hundreds of thousands of dollars to get here. Could you kind of connect that disconnect for me? Because it doesn't make any sense, what you're
sure.
saying.
Sure. Yeah, a lot of money that they get comes from remittances from the United States. A lot of money they get is remittances from the United States to the home countries. Yeah, that's right. And in addition, people get together and they collect money. They borrow money. There are organizations, businesses down there that loan people money. Usually,
please allow the Utah Minuteman Project to respond.
Usually, these businesses are connected directly or indirectly with organized crime. They're more than willing to loan people money as long as they pay it back.
Where do you get those statistics
please.
From?
Department of Homeland Security, United States State Department, trafficking in persons. There's various other organizations that are out there. The United Nations actually puts out a whole enormous amount of information concerning exactly what you're talking about. This is what they track down. This is what they're trying to educate people about, the extent of how they do this. Just to restate the fact that some of these loan sharks, and it's documented in the desert news concerning the Thailand workers here, their loans are at 800% interest. And if they don't pay them, then they lose the property. If not, they lose the family. The drop houses that are so explicitly coming here, these people are extorted at for more money. That's what we want to do.
United for Social Justice has 1 minute, 30 seconds to respond. If they didn't allow each group to have 2 minutes to make a closing statement.
One more question.
No, actually, do you want to respond to that question?
If someone from the Minuteman side has a question, I feel free, because it, just for the sake of equity.
Yes.
We can take one more question?
I come with no agenda, except a lot of experience.
Hold the mic closer, can you switch them?
The challenge is we have to wrap up within the next few minutes.
Yeah. So, well, you're not likely to solve the problem as quickly as that, and that's what we're here to do, is solve the problem. And I don't want to make any ridiculous statements. I want to congratulate Mr. Lucero on his oratory competence, but I think it's kind of overshadowing the process here, which is we're trying to solve the problem. Having worked in Spain, come from Scotland, and I'm an immigrant here, traveled extensively in Mexico, Guatemala, Belize. Those places are nasty. I don't want to make any crass statements here, but how long do you think the trend continues with illegal immigration being overrun by a different culture? It would seem like it would come to a race to the bottom. We would all come down to the level of the poorest part of Mexico, because we would just keep creating. Mexico overran its resources because they had so many people. If we could educate the Mexican women, maybe ask the poor, how long do you think we could sustain the level of welfare that we give to illegal immigrants?
Yeah, well, that's all contingent on whether or not we legalize them and unionize them. Workers in this country, and in most countries, have never really been given a handout. That's a nice story that gets told. It was a fight to change the 12-hour day to a 10-hour day. It was a fight to change the 10-hour day to an 8-hour day. It was a fight to keep children and out of the factories. And this is the real question. If you have a bunch of let's be honest, Mexico is where most of our immigrants come from. If you have a bunch of Mexican immigrants, they're forced to their ground, they can't unionize, they can't coordinate, they have no say in the political process, and all they, not necessarily out of their own viciousness, but because of their systemic position, the only thing that they can focus on is making a living, taking care of their families, and keeping their heads down. And the answer is not very long. But if you bring immigrants to light, you give them the ability to organize, to fight back, not just politically, but economically, then what you'll see is not a degradation of American society, but a flourishing of American society. And to be honest, there's one thing that people have just forgotten, which is television. Yeah, you know, there's Spanish television, but American television does a really good job of naturalizing people. Just like in India, there used to be hundreds and thousands of dialects. But now the majority of India speaks Hindi because the stations are not in Punjab or in Hindi. So again, for us, the solution is bring them to light, allow them to unionize, allow them to organize with American workers, and that will be the new American culture.
The business is unionized out of business. There's not one lump of coal extracted from Scottish soil anymore because the union forced that production abroad.
So I'm going to allow, the United for Social Justice has 2 minutes to make a closing statement. The Utah Minuteman Project has those same 2 minutes, not at the same time. They can respond to that comment during their closing statement.
What about a neutral question?
I think if we want to, there are two things for me that have kind of come out Both United for Social Justice and the Utah Minuteman Project are concerned about cheap labor and about reducing economic human beings essentially to economic actors, I think. Another is the crime, the challenges. Immigration clearly presents challenges and opportunities. And instead of asking a question, I would prefer that each group be allowed to make their closing statement.
We went first, you guys want to go first closing?
It's an intractable problem. I believe that people are accurate when they say that not anytime soon is there going to be a mass deportation, and not anytime soon is there going to be mass amnesty. So, as the gentleman from Scotland pointed out, what we're involved here sooner or later, should our adversaries who advocate open borders wish, is a race to the bottom, where anybody and everybody can feel free to come to the United States and take whatever they want, legally, of course, working hard, doing what people do, but nonetheless, overrunning our society and basically destroying our polity, destroying our national identity. That's what we're worried about. And just for the record, I would like to state that we do have a national identity. And let me just run through it for you. We believe in allegiance to the Constitution and the rule of law. If you're an American, you do. We believe, actually, we are devoted to equality before the law. We believe in the acknowledgement of our Judeo-Christian heritage. You don't have to be Christian, but you have to acknowledge the heritage. English language is what binds us together. Number five is our tolerance. Those are the things that bind us together coast to coast. I don't care whether you are Mexican, Vietnamese, Ukrainian, or where you were born, what your skin color is, what your background is, your national origin is. And I think that's a fair statement historically. So I just like to leave you with that. That we do have a country, and it's worth saving. It's worth working hard to resolve this problem. And resolve does not mean amnesty.
United for Social Justice.
All right, here's the thing. You can notice the gentleman from Scotland actually mentioned, well, you know, you unionize yourself out of a job, you'll just go overseas. Well, that's the problem that we've been saying from the very beginning. Money has no problems traveling borders, but people do. And the reason why is because when money travels, it serves the rich, it serves the corporations, it serves the elites. And when people travel, it doesn't necessarily. So in this case, again, not one solution. It would only be a solution if the problem wasn't systemic and much bigger than just immigration. Now, something really funny to note is one thing that was said was allegiance to the Constitution and rule of law. Was that also the Constitution that considered black people 3/5 of a person? Is that also the Constitution that didn't grant voting rights to women? Or is that to the changing constitution as it exists now? And if it exists now, then why not change it to be more inclusive and include more just? And also, it's about equality under the law. Equality under the law for whom? I know if I get a lot of cocaine and crash my car, I'd probably be spending plenty of time in jail. We know, as a matter of fact, Paris Hilton does a lot of cocaine and crashes her car, and she's just fine. So this equity under the law is only the equity of ancient Greece, the equity of the slaveholders. And also, to say the English language binds us would be quite a shock to the German immigrants at the beginning of our country, the Scots-Irish, the Irish, the French, etc., etc. For me, the American identity, if it means anything at all, it is communities and workers coming together in shared struggle against oppression, against the rich, against the elite. And that is the very essence of the new American identity we must forge, regardless of language or culture.
I have to thank all of you for coming. Thanks to all of our panelists. I think this is a very interesting conversation to listen to. I hope we've all learned something. And perhaps we need another conversation like this. Thank you.